Father, you are so awesome in this place this morning. Thank you for your presence that's here this morning, Lord, Father. To break every yoke and remove every burden this morning, Father. I thank you, Lord, that even as your people just reach out right now, Lord, Father, and grasp hold of what they need from you this morning, Father, everything in their life changes, Father. It takes a holy moment, just one touch from you, one word from you, Father, and things change, Lord. Father, today is that day, Father. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. We thank you for your presence, Father. Because without you, Father, we are nothing. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being here, for being our confidant, for being in our presence 24/7. Thank you for guiding us. Thank you for showing us the way. Father, you are so awesome, my God. We worship you. We give you the glory. We give you the honor, Lord, this morning. Father, you deserve so much more, Father, but we can give you only what we have. And Father, today we just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness in everything that you do. We give you the glory this morning in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. May we see the church. Good morning. Welcome. Is anyone visiting us for the first time? Welcome. Hope you enjoy the service. If you wouldn't mind meeting one of our pastors in the foyer after the service, we'd just like to say hello, see how you enjoyed the service, get to know more about you. Amen. It's my privilege to share on the offering this morning. Pastor Tracy did an offering at the beginning of October on Kronos and Kairos, and took me back to the widow with the olive oil and Elisha, when she had nothing left. So I just want to read the scripture. And it says this in 2 Kings 4, 1 to 7, and from verse 4. The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha, "Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves." Elisha replied to her, "How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house?" "Your servant has nothing there at all," she said, "except a small jar of olive oil." So Elisha said, "Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't just ask for a few. Then go inside, shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour all the oil into the jars, and as each is filled, put it one side." She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her and she kept pouring. When all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another one." But he replied, "There is not a jar left." Then the oil stopped flowing. She went and told the man of God, and he said, "Go sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what is left." So what is interesting about the story in the Bible is that she didn't have much except just a small jar of oil. The man of God asked her, "What do you have in your house? What do you have to offer God today?" And the prophet Elijah then gave her a word, an instruction, and said, "Do everything that I've just read." And she followed it and she was blessed abundantly. See, the provision of oil only stopped flowing once there was no more capacity to receive. In this case, the jars ran out, so the provision stopped. But the blessings to come from the provision saved and protected her sons from slavery. You see, our tithing and offering is similar. God has given us an instruction to bring the tithes and the offerings to the storehouse, the church. You see, God's provisions and protection follows the tithe. The Bible tells us that in the book of Malachi. As long as we tithe, we create the capacity to receive. The windows of heaven will remain open, and God's favor, his protection and provision will always follow us. Don't ever neglect the tithe and the offerings, no matter what you are going through. God will always see you through whatever you are going through. He is a faithful God. Amen. Come, let us pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you this morning, Father, that you are faithful, Father, in everything that you do, Father. Father, I thank you, Lord, that your favor, your protection, your provision, Father, follows us, Father, because you are a God that watches over his word to perform it, Father. And I thank you this morning, Lord, that each one gives and purposes in their heart, Father. Father, you will bless them abundantly. Father, you will meet them at the point of need, Father. I give you the glory for that in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.
And we can say hallelujah. Hallelujah to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords for the power of the cross and the power of the blood. Lord, your blood will never, ever lose its power. Not in our lives. The sacrifice was so great. Lord Jesus, you gave your life. You willingly offered up your life so that we can be saved, so we can be forgiven, given a new life, given freedom from all kinds of bondage. And Lord, we are so grateful today for that. And so we say hallelujah, hallelujah. We give you glory. Lord, in this moment, Holy Spirit, we ask you to have your way in this place. Lord, we want to pray for Bjorn and Gemma's baby who was born, little Gabriella. And Father, as a family, we want to pray for her who's in ICU and on a ventilator. And Father, we just speak healing over that little life, that little blessing you have given this couple. And Lord, we ask you to heal her right where she is right now. Lord, we know there is no distance in prayer, that you're able to move upon that little child. And Lord, as a family, we stand in faith with the mom and dad. And we ask you, Lord, to bring healing into that little baby's life. May the doctors be amazed at how quickly she moves forward and gets better and is even out of there at home. So Lord, we know that our prayer is heard and we know that it's answered. We know that you do not turn your ear away from the prayer of the righteous. And so we together here at Grace Place, we stand in your righteousness. We stand here today believing for that healing now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word that it changes us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Keep baby Gabriella up in prayer over the next few days. And we will see her soon here at church. We will have a picture up next week as well of her once she's out of ICU. So isn't our worship team amazing? Amen. We are blessed. Amen. God has truly blessed us with everyone that's serving. And I promise we are done with speaking to the neighbors today. Okay. I won't ask you. Okay. I said, Splendid, I have to say again to you. So turn to your neighbor. Look at this way. It's fine. It's all right. Thank you, worship team. That was amazing. And everyone who's serving, all the way at the back there. As you see, things are changing. We're busy getting there. The roof is on. We're just going as fast as we can go with what we have. And so we are just trusting that that'll be done hopefully within the next month. So join us. Pray for it. If you can give anything, if you have anything that you can give towards that, even materials or whatever, because we're recycling a lot of things over there, please let us know. But you can see things are changing. Did you see the coffee space is nearly ready? Next week, you can have coffee again and fellowship with great biscuits and coffee and all of that. That's going to take place next week. So I'm looking forward to that. But it's really looking good, don't you think? The mother's room as well, I know it's a bit of a squash here. So please just bear with us over these next few weeks. Soon the mother's room will be in the building that we're busy trying to get finished. We still have to do the offices, which is in the area there. So this isn't all that you're seeing. There's more to the space here. So just give us some time. And if you're willing to come and help, please, you're welcome to do so. So mums, I know it's a squash, but we will get there. Amen from all the mums. Understanding from all the moms, please, and dads that are there. Thank you. And I want to congratulate Pastor Branham. Masters in Business Management. He graduated this week. So congratulations. Well done. I think we need to have one every week. It seems like every week since we've moved into Grace Place, people are graduating, getting masterates and doctors. doctorates and masters and all those, so it's amazing. So keep it up, and we're excited to see what God is going to do in your life and in everyone that's been doing this kind of a thing. You know, Grace Place, our lives, they're made up of decisions, right? We make decisions to go where we want to go, to do what we want to do, and those decisions lead us along a path. And we are where we are today mostly because of a decision that has been made. I'm here because a decision's been made. We are actually all here because just 3 months ago, we made a decision to move here. We're all here because of a choice. And sometimes we make decisions and we're not 100% sure if it's right or if it's wrong. We're not sure if it really is the way we must go. But you know, when God gives us peace, it may not all make sense at the time, but when he gives us peace, we need to understand that that's the decision that we need to go with, because God gives us this peace. And so the decisions that plot our path in this life and in this world is all because of a choice that we make. I don't know how your past has been. I don't know what's happened in your life. I don't know where you all come from. You may know a little bit about us. I may know a little bit about you, but I really want to share today about a principle that you and I can live by. There's actually two of them, in order for us to be victorious. We live in a world and in a time where there are constant battles against us. I hear of people having battles at work with people that are against them, that people are trying to get them out of their workplace. I'm hearing of battles in marriages. I'm hearing of battles in all kinds of areas, battles where they really shouldn't be. And if we want to overcome, the Bible gives us an amazing principle to understand and to live by. And I think the first one is we actually don't understand it. And so as we were worshiping, just more and more, as the Holy Spirit was just revealing like this, we do not understand about the song we just sang, that the blood of Jesus has power. And it will never lose its power for what it can do in our lives. But unfortunately, we feel like it has lost power very often. So I want to read. In fact, if you can open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1. And while you're going to 1 Peter chapter 1, with all of those who have your Bibles here, as Kieran said earlier, the rest you can watch, you can look on the screen. Revelation chapter 12, I want to read that. That's going to pop on the screen first. Revelation chapter 12, while you're turning to the other scripture. And the reason I want it on the screen is because I'm reading it from the Amplified Version. Verse 10 of Revelation chapter 12. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, "Now the salvation and the power and the kingdom, the dominion, the reign of our God, and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our believing brothers and sisters has been thrown down at last. He who accuses them and keeps bringing charges of sinful behavior against them before our God day and night. And they overcame and conquered him because of the blood of the Lamb, and because of the word of their testimony. For they did not love their life and renounce their faith even when faced with death." The Bible is telling us here that there is an accuser who is constantly trying to accuse us of wrong. He stands in the courts of heaven. We've done sermons on this before. He stands in the courts of heaven accusing you and I of the things that we do. But Jesus, who is our advocate, he stands there saying, "But I died for this person. My blood was shed for this person. This person is forgiven. And so they stand before me not guilty." But so often we look at our lives and we look like we're just guilty all the time. And the Bible says there's an accuser of you and I. But in order to overcome this accusation, the Bible says we overcome and conquer him because of the blood of Jesus, the Lamb, and because of the word of our testimony. Two ways we can do this: because of the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Because of the blood of Jesus, we have been forgiven. Do you know that you have been forgiven? We're going to find this out. Let's read 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 17. "And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear." The Bible's telling us to conduct ourselves while we're living on this earth in a way of fear. "Knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by traditions from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." We have been redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. We overcome the enemy by the blood of Christ, the blood of the Lamb. Follow with me as I read Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. We have been redeemed because of the blood of the Lamb. We overcome because of the blood of Jesus. But what does this actually mean to be redeemed? It means we have been saved from our sin and even the consequences of our sin. Now, I understand that when we do things wrong, there are consequences, but the consequences to sin is death. And we have been saved from eternal death, which is the consequence of living a life of sin. And this is the amazing thing that Jesus came to bring us, that he shed his blood so we could be forgiven. Do you know that you are forgiven? Because without knowing that we are forgiven, we cannot move on to the second thing, which is have a testimony. I cannot have a testimony in my life if I do not understand that I am forgiven. Because as long as I feel unforgiven, I will never walk in the fullness of what God has for me. I will never understand the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. And I know we've all made mistakes. We all have missed the mark. And that is what the blood of Jesus Christ is for. That day when he shed his blood for you and I. Some of you are here and you might be thinking, well, I've done terrible things. You know, your terrible thing might be mild to somebody else who's done something far worse. And so we beat ourselves up often, and I'm not saying let's just carry on and live our lives the way we are. We beat ourselves up often, and we look at our lives and we feel like God cannot forgive our sin. And so too many people are walking around in unforgiveness, and therefore they cannot accept God's forgiveness. We walk around in unforgiveness. There are too many people in families fighting with one another. There's no forgiveness. We say there is. It's so easy actually to say, I forgive you, but in your heart, you know whether you have. You know, when there's no eye contact, when you avoid the person, it's a little bit harder to avoid people now here. I mean, in the other place, it was easier. Unless you stay at the back in the corner, then you only come out when you know, you see them go through there when the window's open and you see they're gone, and then you come out and then you're safe, you know? I'm not going to bump into them or sneak through the back here or whatever. I don't know. But we look at our lives and too many of us are walking around in unforgiveness, and we cannot seem to forgive others, even though we say we have, until we truly forgive our brothers and our sisters, the people that are sitting next to us, the people here in this building right now, our family members. We cannot go on and forgive anyone else, and we cannot accept the forgiveness of God, which then means if we cannot accept his forgiveness, how do we move on and fulfill the testimony when I'm walking in shame, when I'm walking in defeat? How do I move on? How do I move forward? Your testimony starts only when forgiveness begins. You are redeemed, and God loves you. But here is the thing, as I was looking at this, I came to realize one thing, because yes, it's actually quite easy to say, I forgive you, and then to work on it and actually forgive that person and actually mend the relationship and carry on with family, carry on with friends. Some people may have hurt you to a degree where you don't need to be a part of their lives, but they're not part of yours and they're not your family. It's a different story. But the one thing that I believe is for many people here today is that we have struggled to forgive ourselves. You've forgiven everyone else, but you haven't forgiven you. Again, if you think of the worst thing you've ever done, or think of that one thing, whenever you pray, you feel like you need to ask God to forgive you again. Lord, forgive me again for the way I spoke 6 years ago. Lord, forgive me again for what I did 35 years ago. Do you know that when God forgives, the Bible says that he forgets, he remembers it no more. And so every time we pray, Lord, remember, he's saying, no, I don't remember. You've asked for forgiveness and I have forgiven you. I have redeemed you because of the blood of Jesus. But we bring it up and we remember. And if we can just get to the point, church, where we understand that we have been forgiven and we can forgive ourselves, we can then move forward. And I believe people are going to be set free here, even right now. Because maybe some of you have lost a loved one. I don't know. And you feel like you've done something And you need their forgiveness, but they're not here to forgive you. And so you walk in unforgiveness towards yourself because of what you've done. Do you know that the power of the blood of Jesus has forgiven you? You know your loved one that's gone and left, they have forgiven you. Because they live in a place where there is no tears, no worries, pure love, pure grace. So maybe you're in this place and you feel like, man, I just trust that you are set free today. Knowing that if God has forgiven you, you can forgive yourself. Maybe things you have said or things you have done, and you feel like, I just struggle to forgive myself. I can't believe I did that. I can't believe. I wish I could just rewind the time, go back to that place and make a different decision so I don't have to live in this kind of space where I cannot forgive myself. There is nothing that you have done that cannot be forgiven. Our Lord Jesus forgives. There is nothing. But here is the key. When we choose to forgive, when we ask for forgiveness and we eventually forgive ourselves, the key is not to go back there. You know, God's grace is amazing. It's for you and I. But if we're constantly going to go back to the same place over and over and over again, we live a life of sin in a habitual way, a habit of it. How can we keep going back to God and ask for forgiveness? When we forgive, our testimony becomes great. And actually, when we forgive and can forgive ourselves, our testimony becomes very much like Paul's. And this is what he said in Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. None of these things move me, because you understand, remember, I think back in Greenstone, we spoke about how Paul did such terrible things to the church. He had people murdered, killed, tortured. He says, none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy in the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify of the gospel of the grace of God. He puts all things aside. He even says, my life is worth nothing. And that's what the Bible said in Revelation. My life is worth nothing. I will even go to the end knowing that I will be the right kind of testimony, knowing that my life will speak of the goodness of God. And here he says, I want to testify of the gospel of the grace of God. I don't know about you, but in order for us to actually testify of the grace of God, we need to accept his forgiveness and forgive ourselves. Otherwise, how can we accept God's grace when we have no grace for self? We need to forgive. Yes, it starts at home, but what about yourself? That's when we have this good testimony. This is the meaning of testimony. It's the evidence or proof of something. What is the proof of your life? I know these are deep questions, because your life could be, well, you know, I did something bad and I never got over it and I never really lived my life to the full because that's my proof. Or I did something bad. I picked up, I asked God to forgive me. I forgave myself. It was a process. It wasn't just like, okay, let me carry on. Obviously, you've worked through the whole story. You've gone through everything. You've made adjustments to your life and you've come to this place where you have a testimony. And people can look and say, wow, I can't believe the testimony of God's grace on that person's life. Look at what they did. Maybe we might know or we might not know, but look where they came from and look where they are today. And when we apply God's goodness and his love and the blood of Jesus to our lives, we have a testimony of something great. So let me ask you, what is the story of grace in your life? What is the story of grace in your life telling other people? Romans chapter 6 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Oh, well, my story is I just live like I like and then I ask God to forgive me and everyone can see that God has forgiven me. What does Paul say? He says, certainly not. We do not live like we want and expect the grace of God just to be there for us every time. He says, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but you're under grace. And so the power of your testimony and my testimony is about God's work in our lives. What he's doing in our lives becomes a direct witness of what we're doing. What is the direct witness of God in your life? And I love what the Bible says here. We're not under the law. We are under grace. But grace does not give us the right to do whatever we like. You know that grace has a standard. We have put the standard of grace so far down There are people that preach a gospel of grace that is wrong, where we can do what we like and just carry on and it's fine. There's a standard to grace. The standard is that God sent his son Jesus who died for us. He shed his blood for us. It is a high standard. It cost a lot. And if my testimony of grace is just going to be, hey man, I fell and God forgave me and I fell. Sorry, that's a Christianese thing. I fell, I didn't literally fall. I sinned, I messed up. And then God forgave me and I sinned and God, you know what? That is not the testimony that we're supposed to be living. We cannot overcome the evil one with a testimony like that. So what is your testimony of grace? Grace place. What is it? Because grace has its own standard. What is the standard of grace in your life? Wow, there's so many questions. What is the testimony of grace in your life? And it can be anywhere. Those of you who are still at school, at university, are you the cool kid that just does whatever they like? Just carrying on with your life. No one would ever think that you trust in God. At work, when you're there, are you undercover? I've shared the story before. We've been to a few businesses, not saying whose, but a few. And the one time we were there and the people that owned the business weren't there. And we said to the people that were working behind the counter, said, oh, we're from Grace Place. You're the people that own this business. Come to our church. They nearly fell over. They nearly collapsed right behind the counter because they couldn't believe that these people went to church. It's shocking. We laugh now, but it's actually, what is the testimony in it? If we had to come to your place of work and ask people, do you know that this, you know, he's in the worship team? You know, she serves on the sound. I'm just saying, there's no judgment here. Okay? I'm asking myself the same questions. I know we're not perfect. We don't always get it right. But what I'm saying is, what is the testimony of God's grace in our lives? Let's get closer to home. What about home? What is the testimony of God's grace? What's the testimony of God's grace in your marriage? When people look at your marriage, what do they think of? Do they go, oh, they just hate each other? Or, oh, they love each other? Or what do people say about your marriage? You know, Belinda and I, we're going away next weekend. It's going to be our 30th wedding anniversary. And so we thought we'd go away for that. I remember when we were married for 1 year and we saw people who were married for 10 years, we thought, how on earth, not because it was bad, but just how on earth, how long do you get to? 10 years, you know, it's like, sure. In the beginning, it is work, let's all be honest, right? I'm not telling any stories, my love, I promise. Okay, it's, there's no stories, she's perfect, right? So, but 30 years on, do you know the one thing we've learned, or there's many, many things we've learned, and that is, you know, when you get married, you don't really know each other. You think you do. I mean, what Belinda and I did, 17th of December, 1992. Ah, that's not even our wedding day, guys. That's the day I asked her to date me. So how many of you can remember that? You're laughing at me. Guys, when did you start dating your wife? Pastor V, do you remember? Okay. So, we started dating. But you know that before we started dating, we actually got to know each other for almost 2 years. I didn't date her to know Belinda. I knew her. Not in the biblical sense. Just to clarify that in case, because we are in church. Okay, sorry. Okay, if you didn't get that one, then go and read the Old Testament, okay? We got to know one, am I going red now? We got to know one another. And the day I asked her to go out with me, it wasn't a day where it was like, oh, let's see where this leads. It was like, this is the girl that I want to marry. And we had a dating period of a year and a bit. There were ups and downs as always. There were things. And but I knew that day that this is who I had prayed for. When I was a young kid, right here. And it was a blessing that God had given to me. And so we got married, obviously in 1994, if you work backwards, on the 5th of November. And you know, through the years, you know, you get married and you think, oh, everything's just going to be fine. It's so nice. We're playing house. Everything's good. Then you get a dog and you go, why? But then you love the dog and you can't think of your life without the dog, you know? And so life carries on. And then we waited for kids for many, many years, have kids. And life just changes as you go. And I think I'm speaking to many people who know. And the one thing that I've noticed is as you're married for longer, for many people, it actually just gets worse. For many people, it becomes difficult. Communication stops. Instead of growing towards one another, people are growing away from one another. And I really believe we are not a perfect couple at all. Well, from my side. Because Belinda just said she's perfect, right? So she's joking. Yeah, we're joking. No one's perfect, right? And we have had things happen through our lives. But the one thing that we have learned and done is to constantly grow towards one another. When things are going wrong, draw towards one another. Forgive one another. Move forward. And I believe that as people are married, as they go along, their testimony starts fading. It starts failing. What was once beautiful is no longer beautiful. And I'm reminded of the kings and the people in the Old Testament. They served God with all their heart in their young years. As they get older, they start turning to other things. They start serving other gods. They start doing things that they were never supposed to do because they basically lose track and stop the discipline in their lives to carry on doing what the Word of God says. And so your testimony as a young married person should be this: to make sure that 20 years down the line, 30 years down the line, that testimony is still good. That even though there have been mistakes, even though there may have been wrongdoings, even though there may have been words that were spoken, even though there are things that have to be forgiven, that you're constantly growing towards one another. What is the testimony of God's grace in your marriage? I don't like to say this. I don't say it gets harder, but things change. People change. Belinda and I, we have changed since 30 years ago. Some of you have known us for all that long. You know how we have changed. But constantly changing towards one another, constantly changing towards our Father and our God brings us to that place. So church, today, if you are feeling like down and out, if there are places in your life where you feel like I just cannot overcome, there is the blood of Jesus, the blood of the Lamb. And if we acknowledge the power of the blood, take it upon our lives, take it upon our marriages, our families' lives, and realize that we are forgiven and we can forgive ourselves, we can truly walk in the fullness of what God has for us. And our testimony, the life that we live, becomes one of grace, and we begin to overcome. Because when we're living in a place of grace, no matter what is thrown at us, we understand who we are in Christ. We understand that we can stand up and overcome every time. When someone comes against us at work, we can stand up and pray and say, Lord, you know I'm serving you. You know that I want my testimony to be one of grace. I don't want to fail in any way here. And so, Lord, I ask you to intervene on my behalf. And very often, God is fighting on our behalf when we don't even know it. There is a cost, though. There is a cost to this kind of life. But the prize is worth everything. So I don't know, church, as I close, where you are in your life, in your marriage, in forgiving yourself. In fact, I want everyone just to close their eyes for a moment. And let's just sing that chorus again in a moment. But I just want to ask you today, you've heard this message and maybe you haven't forgiven yourself because of something that was done, something you did. You've struggled to forgive yourself for someone you cannot even ask forgiveness of anymore. Today, I just want you to receive and experience the grace of God. Because I want to tell you that God's forgiveness is real. The blood that was shed by His Son Jesus has brought that forgiveness. And so today I want to ask you once and for all, once and for all, to put that thing that's been holding you back, where you cannot forgive yourself, and just surrender it to God in this moment. And actually say those words out just quietly where you are in just a moment when we sing. And say, Lord, I know you have forgiven me of this. And today I declare that I forgive myself. I no longer hold it to myself, because your grace that has such a high standard has brought forgiveness into my life. I receive it now. I receive it now. And so worship team, if you can sing that, and whoever it is for, whatever, whoever this is for this morning, please just forgive yourself. Jesus loves you. He did not die in vain.
Oh, the cross of Jesus Christ is the
The sacrifice that Jesus made for your life was for a purpose. That purpose was for today. It was for the mistakes that we would make that we are forgiven of. I want to speak to everyone that's been married for many, many years, maybe 30 years plus, maybe for 20 years plus. I also want to pray for people who maybe have been married. It's could be a second marriage, but you're older, you're more set in your ways, and you're finding it difficult. Just while our eyes are still closed, Father, you see every life in this building, you see every marriage. Lord, marriage is such an important aspect of life, because even our relationship with you is likened to a marriage. We are the bride of Christ, and our Savior is our groom. And so for the most important relationship, which is likened to marriage, Lord, marriage is important. And Lord, today I pray over every marriage in this building. Father, I know some may be failing right now. Some may be towards the end. But Father, wherever the marriages in this place are today, I ask, Lord, in this moment right here, to touch every life. Lord, we so often look at the faults of the other person, but Lord, let's look at ourselves and see what we can change. See how we can make it better. And Father, I pray a blessing on every marriage here. Lord, may they not end. May they fight through the struggles and overcome every time. May their testimony be great, and it may be one of grace. May couples work with one another, walk towards one another, try and understand one another, have favor upon one another, have understanding and compassion. May every marriage have the love that you have for us, an unconditional love. Lord, stir every heart, and may love grow. We speak life over every marriage, blessing. And may each marriage be a testimony of your grace in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Almighty God. You know, the blood of Jesus was poured for you and I. Prophecy in the Old Testament said that Jesus would die on the cross. And he died on the cross for you and I. That prophecy was fulfilled. And he was raised from the dead. And that was the testimony of the cross. The testimony of the life of Jesus. That he would live perfectly on this earth. Die a death in our place. Shed his blood. So that we can be forgiven and then rise again. What a testimony of grace. Today you can become part of that testimony. Today you can become part of the family of God. And it's so simple. The price has already been paid. You don't have to pay the price. You just have to accept the sacrifice Jesus made for you at Calvary. And you accept it by acknowledging him as Lord and Savior of your life. By praying a prayer, confessing that Jesus is your Lord because you believe it in your heart. Today you've heard a message of forgiveness. You've heard that you have been forgiven. You know that you're to forgive yourself, and I believe you have. So to anyone in this place, if you want to give your life to Jesus, and if you want to come back to him, I want to pray for you. So just at this moment, I want to ask everyone to stand, and the worship team are going to play this song again. You know, it was prophesied that when Jesus died on the cross, not one of his bones would be broken. And if you read the account of when Jesus was at the cross, the thieves that were beside him, they broke their legs so that they couldn't stand up and breathe, and they died quickly. But when they got to Jesus, they noticed he was dead. And so they pierced his side, and that's according to prophecy. They pierced his side and blood and water came out. And that was proof that he had died, because some people say, oh no, he didn't really die. But that was proof that he died, because the water will only come out when someone is dead. Well, it looks like water. And so Jesus died for us, and he shed his blood. And they whipped him and broke his flesh just so that we could have eternal life. Today you can accept that eternal life, and I can lead you in a prayer to do so. So as the worship team play this song, if you want to give your life to Jesus, I know it may be uncomfortable, but please let me pray for you. Won't you just slip out from your seats wherever you are while they're singing? Let's pray together. Let me pray for you. So just come down to the front. If you want to give your life to Jesus, just quickly slip out and walk to the front. Is there anybody here today? Is there anyone else? Sing it again here. Just come down if it's you, please. Don't wait for tomorrow. Ask those who are going to be watching online just now, if you'd pray with me, if you would like to receive Jesus as Lord. And Justin, I just want to ask you to pray this prayer after me and just commit your life to God. And today is a new day. The past is gone. And God has great things in store for your life moving forward. Things that you don't even know are waiting for you. things that you've been praying for that you felt like you've never had an answer for, it's coming now. But you need to commit 100%. Okay, let's all pray this prayer together. And say this: My Father in heaven, I believe that your Son Jesus died for me, and I'm forgiven, and I'm set free. And because of it, I'm your child. Today I come back, and I will serve you faithfully. I will be your child as you are my Father. And thank you for loving me and saving me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Father, I pray for your Son, Lord. And Father, we know that as your child, that he has great things in store for him. You have great things planned for his life. And Father, I pray that he will not miss these things that you have for him. That he will never turn away from you again, but he will serve you. And he's made this commitment, knowing that you love him so much and you care for him. So Lord, I just pray that your anointing rests upon him, and that this decision is one for life, the best decision you could ever make. Lord, give him the strength to overcome. And Lord, as you've already spoken into his life, every prayer that he has prayed, Lord, we see the answers. We see restoration in his life and in his relationships. And we see you doing the work that only you can do, for you get all the glory, in Jesus' mighty name. God is good, church. Amen. You can be seated for a moment. You are forgiven, you are set free, and you have the power in your hands to live the testimony of grace that God wants you and I to live. There's someone that's living a testimony of grace today. Yvonne, where are you? Auntie Yvonne, as Belinda's written down here. 79 today. That's also a testimony of God's grace. Where are you? Somewhere. Well, go and ask, who is Yvonne? And then go and wish her happy birthday. All right. Happy birthday. We hope this next year is blessed, and the next decade to come, which is after a year. God bless you. Amen. Who is up next? There we go. Pastor Selesh, thank you.
Turn our attention to the screen for Grace News.
We are getting ready for our annual Christmas outreach, which is dedicated to supporting underprivileged families in our GPO, GPZ, and GPS communities. We believe that every family deserves to experience the joy and warmth of Christmas, and with your help, we can make this possible. We will be distributing food hampers filled with essential items and festive treats to families in need. This outreach aims to bring joy and hope during this special time of year. So we invite everyone to participate by filling out an outreach envelope. These envelopes can be found at the information desk in our church foyer. Your commitment will help us organize the hampers and ensure that every family receives the assistance they need this coming festive season. The Collective is back. We are a community of people within our 20s and 30s that get together every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. If you're looking for a like-minded community to meet midweek, we invite you to join us. Come and see.
Just one more thing, just to, you saw it there, the Christmas market. If you want to register, you can register at in the foyer. The date will be announced in the coming weeks, I'm sure. 6th of December, okay. 6th of December will be the Christmas market, so you can register for a table in the foyer. Amen. Come, let us stand as we close in prayer. Father, we just thank you, Lord Father, for your mercy, your grace, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you went to the cross. Thank you for your blood, Father, that still speaks today, Father. Father, we thank you, Lord, that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, Father. And I thank you, Lord, that even as we go this week, Father, that we will be bold to declare that the blood still has power, Father. That our testimony will be one of forgiveness, one of grace, Lord, Father. Father, we give you the glory, Father. We thank you for everything that you're about to do in our lives this week, Father, until we meet again in Jesus' name. Amen.